On the surface, these built-in colors look pretty basic, and I bet you've had that same thought, and you completely bypassed them and created your own custom colors. Well, actually, the built-in colors are incredibly flexible and provide some key functionality that you don't get with custom colors. So in this video, I'm gonna show you a few different modifiers to get the full potential out of the built-in SwiftUI colors, and give you some reasons why you should try to use the built-in colors over creating a custom one yourself. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Here's why you should use SwiftUI's built-in colors rather than creating your own custom one. With the obvious caveat, like if you're a huge brand, like if you're Starbucks and you need a very specific Starbucks green, yeah, of course. So this isn't absolute advice, but I do believe it's more applicable than not. And what we're looking at here is Apple's human interface guidelines for color. And here it breaks down the built-in colors, right? Dot red, dot orange, dot yellow, dot green. But look what you get for free with SwiftUI. The colors change slightly, whether it's in light mode or dark mode, to make sure they appear as best they can, have the proper contrast, all that stuff. And the colors change based on accessibility settings, like accessibility light, accessibility dark, and they change per platform. Right now, we're looking at the RGB values for iOS, iPad, but these will be slightly different on the Apple Watch or Vision OS, you know, based on the platform, based on the device. That way, the color looks as best as it can, whether you're looking at it on the Apple Watch or you're looking at it on your Vision Pro. And you get that all for free, again, when you use .red, .orange, .mint, .teal, .cyan, .indigo. Versus if you do create your own custom color, your own RGB, or your own hex code, it's going to be that exact shade, that exact color, whether you're in light mode, dark mode, various accessibility settings, whether you're on the Vision Pro or the Watch, it's going to be 100% the same no matter what platform you're on. And Apple has done so much work to tweak these colors ever so slightly so it shows up awesome, again, in all the various modes, light mode, dark mode, accessibility, Vision Pro, all that stuff. So you get that for free by using the basic colors. Now, you may think, cool, but they're still pretty basic colors. I have a much better color in mind. Well, there's actually a few modifiers that can make these colors incredibly versatile. All right, so here I am in Xcode, pretty basic starter project. It's just a VStack with three rounded rectangles. They're all exactly the same. You know, I got a corner radius, style of continuous for the radius, a fill color of .teal, and then a height of 100. Super basic SwiftUI. But I have three different ones, so you can see the different versions of the color in comparison. The first thing I want to show you is that each color has primary, secondary, and tertiary. So primary is just color.teal, what you see right here. But if I do color.teal.secondary, now you see I get a lighter shade. Color.teal.tertiary, an even lighter shade. So here's how you can use the base colors to get some nice visual hierarchy in your UI using the same color palette. Now I do want to say, all these modifiers that I'm going to show you for the rest of the video, they can be used on custom colors that you create. So these aren't exclusive to SwiftUI's built-in colors. However, if you use SwiftUI's built-in color as the base, again, you're getting all that nice Apple goodness gave you with slightly different shades for light and dark mode, accessibility, different platforms, etc. That will be like your starting base color that you can then apply all these modifiers to. So that's primary, secondary, tertiary. Again, real quick, visual hierarchy right on your color. Next up, I want to show you dot gradient, which was new in iOS 16, so dot gradient. And then you see here, let's get rid of the secondary and tertiary so you can see the gradient comparison. So over on the right, the top rectangle has a gradient. Now you can see it's very, very subtle. It's very tasteful, very classy. Now I'm not saying more bold gradients aren't tasteful or classy, but that's what you get when you use dot gradient. Now, if you do want a more bold, very colorful, different type of gradient, well, that's when you have to do, instead of color.teal.gradient, you know, you have to do linear gradient with color, start point, end point, all that stuff. But again, a real simple modifier on a color is just dot gradient. And again, it's very, very subtle, but I think it looks really good. I use this all the time in like all my apps. You can also combine these modifiers. So if I do teal.gradient.secondary, now I have the secondary teal that is a gradient. And this one, you thought that top one was subtle? Well, this one's even more subtle. So I'll do dot secondary on the bottom rectangle so you can compare them top to bottom. And I'll even like super zoom in. You can tell the difference if you look closely between the bottom two rectangles. It is a very, very subtle gradient. But oftentimes the best designs are just so, so subtle. Now the rest of the modifiers are interesting because they take in a specific value, which means you can be very, very specific with them, but it also means you can animate them. Let me show you. So first of all, let's create a at state private var, let's say color value, say double, we'll say it equals 0.5 by default, and we'll give us a slider down here. Actually, we'll do it above the spacer so we can see it. I have my preview pretty zoomed in. So you can see slider, it's the color value 0 to 1, because the values we're gonna pass into these modifiers are from 0 to 1. So let's go back to just teal on all these, kind of reset back to default, get rid of our gradients and our secondary so I can show you these. So the first one we're gonna do is new in iOS 18. So this is only available in iOS 18 and above, but it is mixed width. So how I like to use this, so you see mixed width by, so mixed width is whatever color you wanna use this. Now you can use obviously any color you like, but how I typically use this is, I don't know, a lot of times I wanna darken up a color a little bit, so I'll mix it with black. And then this number here, again, 0 to 1, is what percent do we want to be black? So if I want to darken it just a little, I can do 0.1%. And you can see at that top bar got darkened just a little. Well, if I want it a lot darker, 0.5%, that's a really dark teal. 0.8, okay, now we're getting basically black. If we go back to 0.2, again, just a darkened color of my original teal. Now it doesn't have to be black. Let's mix it with .indigo. There you go. That is teal mixed with indigo by 0.2. Now if we do 0.7, now it's a little more purple. So you can see we're mixing and matching colors and we're determining like how much we're mixing this by. And like I said, because this is a value, instead of hard coding it there, I can say color value. And because color value is attached to my slider down here, now I'm mixing with indigo, and right now we're default 0.5, but I can take my slider and then watch the top one, and now we're sliding. Oh, that's all the way back down to teal. And then this is pretty much gonna be all the way to indigo and everything in between. So you can animate that, you can have the user manipulate it, however you like. So that is mix width, and again, new in iOS 18, it's awesome. You can basically create any color you want by mixing two colors. Super cool. All right, let's get rid of the mix width back to the default teal here. Now, the next one is .brightness. And again, any amount, 0 to 1. Actually, this can go negative as well. You'll see fill style requires it some view. So brightness has to be on a view and color is a view. You'll notice in the fill, it requires a shape style. So where you use your colors, some of these modifiers, you know, will be available right on the color, or you just have to put them down on the next line. So if you see, hey, this requires a shape style or this requires a view, that's what you're running into. So we'll do brightness 0.5 and then look at the top one. So that upped the brightness by 0.5. I think we can do negative numbers here too. Yeah, we can, that's a little darker. So we could adjust our slider to be -1 to 1, but I'm not gonna mess with that. But you can see again, the slider, we're adjusting the brightness and we're not because I didn't plug in color value. I hard coded it, color value. There we go. The default is 0.5. And then, you know, we're scrolling down to 0 and then up to brightness of 1. So again, you can animate this. The user can manipulate it via slider, stepper, whatever. And you can create basically whatever version of this you want by adjusting the brightness value. And again, same thing for grayscale. You saw I used mix width to like darken it up a little bit. Well, now this can kind of like dull it out, make it more gray. So again, grayscale, again, 0 to 1. 0 looks like teal, there's no grayscale at all. All the way up, it is gray, and then everything in between. Maybe you want a gray with a slight tinge of teal. There you go. So you can apply the grayscale modifier to your color and then add a value from 0 to 1. How much gray do you want to put in that teal? As you can see, I'm slowly sliding it back. So as you can see, these modifiers on the colors, you can basically make anything you want with them. And again, the modifiers can be applied to your custom colors, but you get all the benefits of accessibility stuff, looking different in light mode, dark mode, by using the built-in SwiftUI colors. So if you can, I would highly recommend trying to use those. And if you're here learning new tricks for SwiftUI Color, I know you're building awesome apps, and I think it's best to have a website to show off your work, whether that's a portfolio to show off your projects or the official website for your app on the App Store. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace, handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.